A long time ago, I was a new Boy Scout. My uniform was new and I hadn't earned any badges yet. My first camping trip was one where we had to carry everything we needed. My mom helped me by using a laundry bag and some clothesline to make a backpack. It wasn't perfect, but it was all we had. The trip started off okay, but halfway through, the ropes started to hurt my shoulders. The pain was too much, and I dropped the bag, spilling everything on the ground. I was close to crying, trying to pick up my stuff when a scoutmaster from another troop saw me. He was an old hand at hiking, and you could tell he'd been doing this for a while. Without saying anything, he helped me tie the bag to his hiking stick. This made the weight easier to handle, and he walked with me to the campsite. The camping part went well. I learned how to set up a tent, make a fire, and cook my own food. Just before we started the hike back, I saw that my troop's tents and gear were being loaded into a truck. I saw my chance, threw my bag in the truck, and only kept my sleeping bag, which I tied to my shoulder with the clothesline. The hike back was a lot easier, and I learned an important lesson that day: always have the right equipment for your trip. Years later, when I was an experienced scout, I was on a similar camping trip. This time, I was the one with the old face and the hiking stick. On the way back, I saw a new scout from another troop having trouble with his gear, looking like he was about to cry. It was like looking at myself from the past. I stopped, and together, we tied his stuff to my hiking stick. As we walked out of the woods, I couldn't help but smile. What goes around, comes around, and I was happy to be able to help someone else the way I had been helped. It was a clear reminder that every hard time we go through is a chance to learn, grow, and maybe one day, help someone else in need. It was getting dark when I started my hike alone in the thick forest. The air was fresh, and the only sound was the leaves crunching under my feet. I thought I was alone, but I was wrong. As I walked deeper into the woods, I heard something moving behind me. When I looked back, I saw a family of brown bears coming out from the bushes. They stayed away, but they were clearly interested in me. They were following me, and I didn't know why. A scary thought came to me: were they hungry? Was I their next meal? I started walking faster, but the bears kept up. Every time I stopped to rest, they got a bit closer. My heart was beating fast as I realized how dangerous this was. Then, when I stopped to drink some water, I found a bag of homemade trail mix in my backpack. I had forgotten to leave it in the bear bag at the camp. Was this why the bears were following me? They must have smelled it. Without thinking twice, I left the trail mix where I was sitting and climbed up the nearest cliff. I watched as the bears went straight for the trail mix, ignoring me. They didn't follow me anymore. It was crazy to see how good their sense of smell was. If they were black bears, I wouldn't have been so worried. They're usually scared of people. But brown bears, they're different. They're not scared and will attack you for a single candy you forgot in your pocket. As I kept hiking, I started to calm down. I felt a new respect for the forest and its animals. I realized that in their world, I was the stranger, and they were just trying to survive. This experience was a strong reminder of how tough and unforgiving nature can be. It taught me to be more careful, to respect the animals, and most importantly, to check my backpack before going on a hike. The encounter with the brown bears was scary, but it was also a lesson I'll never forget. As the sun was going down, my wife and I started our walk. We were going through a thick forest. The air was fresh and smelled like pine trees and wet soil. We both loved to hike, but this path was tough because it was steep and full of rocks. As we went higher, the path got narrower and the sides got steeper. My heart was beating fast, not just because of the hard walk, but also because it was a bit scary. I was watching my wife closely. Her shape looked beautiful against the sunset. Suddenly, she slipped on a rock. It felt like time slowed down as she started to fall down the steep side. My heart stopped, and I couldn't breathe. But then, luckily, she was able to stop herself from falling too far. She got up, cleaned herself off, and said she was okay. But I could see she was scared. We both knew she could have been hurt really bad. We decided to stop our walk early. The fun was gone, and we were reminded how dangerous nature can be. As we walked back, I felt really thankful. We had been in a scary situation, but we were okay. This reminded us how nature can change quickly and how important it is to be safe. We will always remember this hike, and we will tell this story for many years. Even though it was scary, it made us feel closer and reminded us how important life is and how strong our love is. It was a dark night, and the only light was from my campfire. I was on a hiking trip by myself, deep in the woods. The air was fresh and smelled like pine trees and wet soil. I was sitting by the fire, holding a flask of whiskey. The warmth of the whiskey was making me feel less cold. The night was quiet, except for the sound of the fire and an owl hooting far away. Then I heard a noise. It was the sound of leaves rustling behind me. At first, I thought it was just the fire or the wind. But the noise kept getting louder and closer. I started to feel nervous. The rustling was too regular, too purposeful. It was something alive, something coming towards me. I put my flask down, my heart beating fast. I held my hatchet in one hand and my flashlight in the other. I stood up, trying to move as fast and smoothly as I could, but the whiskey had slowed me down. I turned around, shining my flashlight into the darkness, and there it was. The scary creature that had been following me was not a creature at all. It was a deer, its eyes wide and reflecting the light from my flashlight. It was very close, so close that I could see its breath in the cold night air. We just looked at each other for a moment, both of us frozen. Then, just as quickly as it had shown up, the deer turned and ran off into the darkness. I could see two more pairs of eyes in the distance, disappearing as the deer joined them. I couldn't help but laugh, feeling the fear leave my body. It seemed like they were playing a game, trying to see who could get closest to me without getting caught. I sat back down by the fire, picked up my flask, and took a sip of the whiskey. The night didn't seem so quiet anymore. The sounds of the woods were like music to my ears. I realized then that even when I was scared, the woods were just alive, just breathing, and I was just a small part of it. Later that night, as I got into my sleeping bag, the flask empty next to me, I couldn't help but smile. The encounter with the deer, as scary as it had been at the time, was now just another story, another memory. And as I fell asleep, the sounds of the night were like a soft song, and I knew that this was a trip I would always remember. I've always liked being outside. I enjoy the sounds of nature, the excitement of exploring, and the beauty of the natural world. So, when I moved to Washington State, I knew I had to check out the well-known Burroughs Mountain Trail in Mount Rainier National Park. The trail was amazing. It went on for miles across highland scenery, with Mount Rainier, a huge 14,410 feet high mountain, standing tall in the background. The trail was in good shape, going through quiet old forests, river valleys, and high meadows. One day, I decided to walk the trail by myself. I packed my stuff, put on my boots, and started early in the morning. The air was fresh, the sky was clear. I could hear a bird calling in the distance, the sound of leaves crunching under my feet. As I went further into the trail, the forest got thicker. The sunlight came through the trees, making long shadows. Suddenly, I heard a noise behind me. I looked back, but saw nothing. I thought it was just a small animal and kept walking. But the noise followed me. It got louder, closer. My heart was beating fast. I walked faster, but the noise seemed to keep up. I could feel my heartbeat in my ears. I was alone, far away from any people. Suddenly, I came to a clearing. The noise stopped. I could see the top of Mount Rainier in the distance, its snowy top shining in the afternoon sun. I took a deep breath, feeling a wave of relief. I spent the rest of the day exploring the trail, enjoying the amazing views of the mountain and the highland scenery. As the sun started to go down, I headed back, the noise now just a memory. That night, as I sat by my fire, I realized that the noise was just a part of the wilderness. It was the sound of the forest, the sound of nature. It was a reminder of the excitement of exploring, the beauty of the wild, and the joy of walking. In the end, my solo walk on the Burroughs Mountain Trail was an experience I'll never forget. It was a journey of learning about myself, a sign of the power of nature, and a reminder of the beauty of the wild. And even though I was scared at first, I wouldn't change it for anything. It was a sunny day and I started climbing the hill. The path was rough with sharp stones sticking out, and the air smelled like pine trees and wet soil. I was following three older people who were hiking at a steady speed. Suddenly, one of the women tripped over a stone and fell. She hit her head on a sharp stone and started bleeding. I could see her skull through the cut on her forehead. Her friend, a tall man, started to freak out. Even though I don't like the sight of blood, I knew I had to help. I quickly found my first aid kit in my bag. My friend saw what was happening and started to calm the man down. I focused on the woman who was hurt, trying to ignore the sight of her skull. I cleaned her cut as best as I could, then put a bandage on it to stop the bleeding. I tried to distract her by talking about her favorite hiking spots. Just as I finished helping her, another group of hikers found us. They agreed to help get the woman down the hill, and her friend went with her. When they were out of sight, I felt relieved. But then, I started to feel dizzy. I had to lie down. My friend stayed with me, giving me water and encouraging me until I felt better. Later, when we were going back down the hill, we met some hikers who had seen the woman and her friend at the start of the trail. They told us she seemed fine but was going to the hospital to be checked. I was relieved to hear she was okay. The rest of the hike was normal, but I kept thinking about what had happened. It reminded me that nature can be unpredictable, and it's important to be ready for anything. But it also showed me that I can help others even when I'm scared. It was a frightening experience, but also a good lesson. I had always wanted to go camping in Wyoming, the best state of America for camping. I had heard so many stories about the beautiful scenery, the abundant wildlife, and the peaceful atmosphere. I decided to rent a cabin in Scott State Park, a 1,280-acre park that featured a stunning lake, a historic pueblo, and several hiking trails. It sounded like the perfect place to relax and enjoy nature. I arrived at the park on a sunny afternoon and checked in at the ranger station. The ranger gave me a map and a key to my cabin, which was located at the far end of the park, near the lake. He warned me that there was no cell phone service or Wi-Fi in that area, and that I should be careful of bears and other wild animals. He also told me that I was the only one staying in that cabin, and that the nearest neighbor was about a mile away. I thanked him and drove to my cabin. The cabin was small but cozy, with a wooden porch, a fireplace, and a kitchenette. It had one bedroom, a bathroom, and a living room with a sofa bed. I unpacked my bags and settled in. I decided to go for a walk around the lake before it got dark. I grabbed my camera and a bottle of water and headed out. The lake was breathtaking, with clear blue water reflecting the sky and the mountains. I saw some ducks and geese swimming on the surface, and some fish jumping out of the water. I walked along the shore, taking pictures and enjoying the fresh air. I felt so calm and happy, like I had left all my worries behind. I was about to turn back to the cabin when I noticed a small wooden sign that said, "Trail to Pueblo." I was curious about the historic site, so I decided to follow the trail. It was a narrow dirt path that led into the woods. I walked for about 15 minutes, until I reached a clearing. There, I saw the ruins of an ancient stone building, surrounded by a wooden fence. It looked like it had been abandoned for centuries. I approached the fence and read a plaque that explained the history of the Pueblo. It said that it was built by the Pueblo Indians around 1200 AD, and that it was a ceremonial center and a trading post. It also said that it was the site of a massacre in 1864, when a group of soldiers attacked the pueblo and killed most of the inhabitants. The survivors fled and never returned. The plaque ended with a warning. This is a sacred and haunted place. Respect the spirits of the dead and do not enter. I felt a chill run down my spine as I read the last sentence. I looked at the pueblo and wondered what horrors had happened there. I felt a sudden urge to leave, but I also felt a strange attraction to the place. I wanted to see what was inside. I ignored the warning and climbed over the fence. I walked towards the entrance of the pueblo, which was a small hole in the wall. I had to crouch down to get in. As soon as I entered, I regretted my decision. It was dark and cold inside, and I could smell something rotten. I turned on the flashlight on my camera and looked around. I saw piles of bones, skulls, and pottery shards. I saw bloodstains on the walls and the floor. I saw a fire pit with charred remains. I realized that I was standing in a mass grave. I felt sick and terrified. I wanted to get out of there as fast as I could. I turned around and ran towards the exit. But as I did, I heard a loud thud behind me. I looked back and saw that the entrance had collapsed. A pile of rocks and dirt had blocked the hole. I was trapped. I screamed and pounded on the wall, hoping that someone would hear me. But no one came. I was alone in the dark, with the dead. I felt a cold hand touch my shoulder. I turned around and saw a faceless figure standing behind me. It was wearing a feather headdress and a leather tunic. It was one of the Pueblo Indians. It was a ghost. It grabbed me by the neck and lifted me off the ground. I struggled and kicked, but it was too strong. It opened its mouth and let out a blood-curdling scream. I felt its teeth sink into my flesh. I felt its breath on my face. I felt its hatred in my soul. I blacked out. I don't know how long I was unconscious. When I woke up, I was lying on the ground, outside the fence. I was covered in blood and dirt. I had bite marks all over my body. I was alive, but barely. I crawled to the trail and followed it back to the lake. I saw my cabin in the distance. I saw a light on the porch. I saw a figure standing there, waiting for me. It was the ranger. He saw me and ran towards me. He helped me up and carried me to his truck. He drove me to the nearest hospital. He saved my life. He told me that he had come to check on me, and that he had found my camera on the trail. He had looked at the pictures and had seen the one I had taken of the pueblo. He had recognized it and had known that I was in trouble. He had gone to the pueblo and had found the collapsed entrance. He had dug me out and had brought me back. He asked me what had happened. I told him everything. He believed me. He said that he had heard stories about the pueblo and that he had seen things there that he couldn't explain. He said that I was lucky to be alive, and that I should never go back there. I agreed. I never wanted to see that place again. I never wanted to go camping again. I never wanted to leave my home again. I survived, but I was scarred for life. I still have nightmares about the pueblo, and the ghost that attacked me.